So I'm very happy to introduce Konstantin Klinger and Sascha Steinbiss. Sorry. They have been part of the community for quite a few years now. We've met quite a few times. And they have taken it up on themselves to document the EVE.json, something that I'm ashamed to say we should have done ourselves. But they are very, they very kindly offered to help. And today they will talk about their experiences and ideas. So, Sascha and Konstantin.
Yeah, thanks for the introduction, Victor. So what we're going to talk about today actually started last year, during SuriCon 2018, when we decided to take over one of these Redmine tickets. As you can see, it reads document all record types and fields in EVE.json. Turns out that's not exactly what we did, but what we did was a building block on the way to that final goal. First, a quick word about DCSO, so the company that we both work for. We're a managed security service provider based in Berlin, Germany. We're doing all sorts of cyber-related stuff, but one very large part of their business is network security monitoring as part of the threat detection and hunting service. And in that service, we've been using Suricata for quite a long time, and as Victor already said, there are a couple of ties with the community. Okay, so let's quickly look at what life looked like before EVE.json. So Suricata 2.x just had a couple of text-based formats for both alerts and metadata. So fast.log was basically a line-based format. It just listed all the necessary information that was connected to a particular alert. And also for each of the metadata types, there was one particular text file that listed all the details, for example, down here for DNS. Complementary to that was Unified 2, which was a binary format that, in addition to the alert metadata, also contained the packet. Being a binary format, you needed some particular special tooling to work with it afterwards. And as far as I gathered from the previous talk, it's going to be history anyway. So what was the way forward? Suricata 2.0, released in 2014, introduced the EVE.json format, which is basically a generic way to represent alerts and metadata in one common JSON-based format. As was already said before, Tom DiCanio of NPulse implemented that. And so just everyone's on the same page afterwards. This is what it looks like. It's a large-ish JSON object that contains metadata about the event itself, a timestamp, the event type that tells us what kind of event we're looking at, and then all the necessary information that is connected to that event, right? So each of the individual protocols, for example, has one sub-object that contains all the information that deals with that particular protocol. So this, as you can see, this is quite a complex format, right? There's lots of different fields in there. So if you want to actually do some downstream work and use that format, you would need some kind of documentation that tells you what's actually in there. So at the moment, there is a read-the-docs-based documentation that's included with the actual Suricata project documentation. But it always looked to me like it's a bit opportunistic, right? So if anything new comes up or if anything needs explanation, it's just added to the read-the-docs files. But it's not really exhaustive, right? So it's not really clear what fields exist, right? So there's no actual list of fields that are available, what the values mean that are connected to these individual fields, and how they depend on each other. So for example, what event type carries what particular sub-objects. That's one thing. And also, if you actually want to work with a format, there are several ways to do it, right? Depending on your programming language, you would have to check whether each field actually exists in the object you're trying to pass and whether the string that you find there can be passed into the kind of type that you expect, like an integer, a sub-object, an array, and so on. It's either that or providing some kind of predefined structure, like a struct definition, that needs to be updated whenever the contents of this EVE.json changes. So one project is this Survigo that one of my colleagues wrote for Go, and that would need to be updated each time there's a new protocol parser. So for example, with the release of the RDP and the SIP parsers in 5.0, we wouldn't have needed to update this. So why don't we just do static checking, right? We've got the source code, so Ricardo's open source. Why don't we just look at what the developers originally implemented? So it turns out it's not that easy. There's a library called libjanson that is being used to actually create the JSON output, but it's a quite dynamic library. So what you do is actually manipulate all the different JSON objects in memory, connect them to each other, so there's no complete predefined structure that we could just pass from the source. So just doing static source analysis won't really give us a reliable documentation of how these different JSON nodes fit together. So what we decided to do was to follow some kind of empirical approach. We would just use Suricata itself to create JSON output from a predefined set of input, and then use that output to derive a schema. And then we do this for each Suricata version that was released since 2.0. to derive a version-specific set, and then unify them and use them as a way to bootstrap documentation from there. And yeah, hopefully we can also catch some bugs on the way and maybe find other interesting things. So this is what our workflow looks like. We start with input preparation, so we gather the necessary input data to actually do the workflow. So that's PCAPs, that's rule sets, and that's configuration that we need for Suricata. Then we build containers for each version and run these inputs against them, ending up with a set of EVE.json files. Then we create JSON schema files from them, integrate them across versions, and then use that to create restructured text templates that might fit well with the current Sphinx documentation. But we get into each of these steps in detail now, and Konstantin is going to start with input preparation.
Yeah, to have a proper Suricata run, we need to collect PCAPs, we need to define rule sets, and we need to configure our Suricata YAML configuration files. So for the PCAPs, we try to collect open source available non-commercial PCAP sets from the Wireshark wiki, from the MIT, from Zeek, from Chris Sanders on GitHub. There was also a sort of ICS Gator library on GitHub, where you have a lot of PCAPs that are public available. But when looking into the output fields and checking if every event type and every protocol was detected with the metadata, sometimes we need to manually add some traffic samples because some fields were not triggering. So if you find something that is not there, you can add manually PCAP samples via GitHub pull request. Our intention was to have a high diversity of normal traffic samples, but also to cover typical anomalies. In the end, we had around about 1,000 files, 1 gigabyte of PCAP data, and over 5 million packets. On the picture on the right side of the slide, you can find the app proto distribution. This statistic was generated with Suricata 5.0. So there you can find every app layer protocol that is supported by Suricata 5.0, which tells us that we have full coverage of each protocol Suricata supports. We tried to generate also statistics with Wireshark and Netstat and some other tools, but it was not able for us to get a smooth statistic that was integrated in our workflow. So Suricata is the best thing here to see if we have a good coverage of every traffic that we need. Secondly, we need to prepare rule sets because we want to generate a huge amount of EVE.json output, so we want to generate and trigger a lot of alerts. So what is best for that? It's the ET rule set for Suricata 2, for Suricata 4, and also for Suricata 5, and the event rules that come with Suricata when installing it. Then we also created sort of protocol-specific and file store rules, so-called dummy rules. As you can see here, an example, it's an alert HTTP any rule that triggers on every HTTP packet. With this kind of concept, we managed to generate output for each protocol and generate a lot of EVE.json logs. Further, you need to enable everything in the Suricata configuration. So you need to enable all protocols, not only in the app layer section, you need to enable them also in the EVE output section. And you need to enable every additional output that could be part of the if.json log. For example, the x-forwarded for header in the HTTP protocol, or we have to enable the extended SMTP HTTP TLS logs. We have to enable metadata, NetFlow, and everything that could be part of the if.json output. Yeah, we assumed that Rust were enabled, and we assumed that we will use the latest possible version, because, for example, there is DNS version 1 and 2, and there is FileStore version 1 and 2, and with the introduction of version 2, we always used version 2. And if Suricata could be built with Rust, we build it with Rust. So at the moment, we have only one runtime configuration and one build per Suricata version. And one could say in the future we should divide that and maybe make different configurations to generate more output and logs for one version. So I will hand over to Sasha.
Okay, so let's move on with actually running Suricata against the input that was just explained. So what we actually did was just build a set of Docker images. So for each of the Suricata releases after version 2.0, we downloaded, so we just checked out the source code from GitHub that was tagged with the corresponding version number, then adjusted the build scripts to not use configure options that weren't present in a particular version. So we have a set of build scripts. The Docker containers that were built this way for all these different versions were uploaded to Docker Hub for anyone to use. And then what we did was just take our set of PCAPs and run it against each of these versions in an automated fashion. And just for the sake of compatibility between versions, we decided to run Suricata separately on each PCAP. So I know that some newer versions of Suricata actually support passing a directory with PCAPs to Suricata itself. But yeah, just for the sake of simplicity, we decided to do it individually. And also, just to simulate the behavior of drop events, we also used the simulate IPS switch to Suricata to simulate what would happen in an inline situation. So that's what our Docker setup looks like. We have a common set of PCAP files. We have a common set of rules, just like Konstantin just said. And we mount them inside the container as top-level directories, PCAPs, and rules, which are then specified in the configuration. But the configuration is version-specific, obviously. So some things are only supported in particular versions. So we have, for each Suricata version, one subdirectory that contains configs and also acts as a place to receive the logs that are produced by the Suricata run. So that's how we automatically can create large sets of these results. And we've automated the whole process in a fashion that we can run several containers runs in parallel, and that we can reliably start and stop this whole operation. OK, let's talk about the next step, which is transferring the raw if.json output to JSON schema. So just in case not everyone knows about JSON schema, that's basically some kind of vocabulary or a means to actually annotate and explain what JSON documents are like in terms of structure, and also to validate the whole thing afterwards. So there is an explanation about the structures, so what fields are present and how are they connected to each other. It says something about the types that each of these fields can have. Is it an integer? Is it a string? Is it a sub-object? And it also says something about the presence requirements. So for example, given an input set, do we have a particular field that is present in all of them, or that can be just optional? And the whole thing is specified in JSON itself. So basically, we're transferring one JSON file to another that explains the previous one. And there is tooling available that allows us to just given a particular evidence file, come up with one of these JSON schema files. And we decided to use Jensen, which is a Python-based tool just to do exactly that. What you do in this case is you start with an empty or with a predefined seed schema and extend this with each piece of JSON that you see in the if.json files. So sometimes that doesn't completely work the way it should. For example, in the stats event type, there is a threads subobject, where the keys carry information. So for each thread that Suricata runs as, there is one key in there. So since this is runtime dependent, we don't want to include all of these different variations in the documentation, right? Because that's not really something that's helpful. Luckily, in a JSON schema, there is a pattern functionality that allows us to just say, okay, beneath the threads sub-object, we have keys that just fit a particular pattern, and then they're not enumerated individually anymore. So that's what we did to tackle that problem. And on the other hand, since we just used pcaps, there are a couple of fields that are only set if you don't use pcaps, but if you just if you use live capturing. So for example, you can only have the pcap count field if you use pcaps, but you only have the in iface, the interface name, if you do live capturing. So to just include both of them in our output, we decided to also include the in iface in our seed to make sure it's not dropped in the output. Okay, so now that we have a set of JSON schema files for each version, how do we combine them to form one, one integrated version independent schema? So we merge them all together. So we create a union of all the different fields that we see and annotate each of these fields with the first and the last version of Suricata that we've seen that field in. And to make documentation easier, you'll see in a minute why this is useful, we collapse all the stats delta fields, so the incremental values, collapse into the non-delta counterpart and document them at the same time, because that reduces the number of fields that we need to deal with quite a bit. And for each field, we create restructured text, so RST pages. The structure that we see in the JSON schema is directly converted to sections and subsections in the RST documents. And we distinguish between an outer template, which contains data that can change, overruns, and an inner template that contains actual content that a curator would write that's supposed to stay the same between versions. So after this, the automation that we have in place for that runs, we end up with a Sphinx-compatible RST tree that is ready to be inserted or combined with the current Suricata documentation, and that could also be a good basis to create a unified general JSON schema file. We might want to discuss if that's of any help to you, if you, for example, want to automatically generate other kinds of documentation from that. Okay, I'm going to hand over to Konstantin with the findings of what we did.
So in this slide, you can see the sum up of the EVE.json format evolution, starting with Suricata 2 in the beginning, and now the latest release, Suricata 5.0, with 1,055 fields. If you compare it to Suricata 2, there have only been 53 fields. So in the beginning, there was only alert, HTTP, TLS, SSH, and I guess file info available. And then it increased. With Suricata 3, there is the big blue and the big green line introduced, which is the stats and the stats delta fields. So there is a huge amount of stats fields available. So those fields make most of the EVE.json output fields. Also, there was NetFlow and Flow in general, email and TCP introduced there. Then if you look into Suricata 3.2, there was the DMP3 parser, which has a lot of metadata fields available. So there is an increase, of course. And also the stats gets extended, and TLS was introduced with more metadata. Then if you go on to Suricata 4, there is another peak with a tunnel protocol introduced, and also the stats gets increased more from version to version. And you have with Suricata 4.1 many new parsers like the DHCP, EKAV2, Kerberos, DNS version 2, of course, because there is more metadata than before in version 1. Then you have SMB, which is the black line. As you can see, there is a huge increase here. And also, again, stats are increasing heavily. So then you have Suricata 4.1.3, the last peak, and now we are up to Suricata 5, which the new event type Animally, which was introduced, and the RDP, SIP, and SMP parser, and also FTP has now metadata available. So that's it. That's the whole evolution of the EVE.json format. And we also found some interesting findings during our journey when analyzing the data we produced. So there was not only an increase of fields from version to version, it was also interesting that from Suricata 3.1.2 to 3.1.3 and to 3.1.4, there was a decrease in some stats fields, which I find is interesting to mention here. Also, in Suricata 3.0, we found a bug which is on Redmine 1707, which is called malformed JSON if message is too big. So there was overly large JSON output produced by our runs, which couldn't be parsed by the consuming software we used, which was Jensen, as Sasha just said, and JQ. So this is fixed with Suricata 3.1, but it broke our automation process with Suricata 3.0, so we need to make a workaround and cut those lines out, but we also lost some data here. Responsible fields for those large output were the payload and packet and payload readable fields, because the whole packet was stuffed into the JSON and it was larger than the maximum number allowed by JQ and Jensen. Also, we weren't able to produce any output of the MSN protocol detection parser, because during our QA we checked if we have every event type we can find and every metadata we enabled in the Suricata YAML configuration. So we checked if everything was there. And it was not possible for us to produce any event type, any alert, or any metadata for the MSN protocol. So this was a bit odd, and now the MSN protocol is removed with Suricata 5.0. Also, there is the case of the missing metadata event type. Introduced with Suricata 4.1.0, there is an event type called metadata, and it should be triggered whenever a packet var is saved. But it's in the EVE output section, and we won't be able to produce any event type for that. So if someone of you knows how to do that, we would be really glad if you can give us a hint afterwards. Also, which was interesting because our automation process need to be adapted again. As said before, we used dummy rules for like file store, and in Suricata 2 there was no SMTP parser because it was introduced with Suricata 3.0. And you can break the rule engine if you put this SMTP file store rule into Suricata 2, because then there is a segmentation fault by the rule engine. So we need to then divide our rule sets for Suricata 2 and afterwards and make a good approach here. So let's look at the result. On the slide, you can see on the left side and on the right side, the community ID field documentation integrated in the official Suricata Read the Docs documentation. So this is how it could look like in the future. If we look more into detail into this community ID documentation, you can see the automated fields, auto-generated fields, which Sasha just mentioned. It's the type of the field, it's the first supported Suricata release, the last supported Suricata release, and the date this documentation was generated. It's the section above. In the section below, which is not overwritten with each documentation run, it's the actual documentation. So we thought that there should be a short 1 to 2 sentence description of the field. Then, for example, for the community ID field, which is only present in the EVE.json output if you enable it in the Suricata YAML configuration, you need to mention that here, because one could not know how to trigger this field or how to get this field into the if.json output if you don't know how to configure it properly. Then, of course, an example is always good. How does this field look like in a whole if.json event? And we thought about adding an external reference, in this case, to the official GitHub repository for the community ID, and in other cases, for example, to the RFC of the HTTP protocol where the hostname field is defined. To sum everything up, what are our next steps? So we have some limitations at the moment. As said before, we are only using one build and one runtime configuration per Suricata version. So we need to divide that into more runs and more builds per version in the future. Then we don't support non-scalar value types in the JSON objects. Then at the moment we produce huge amount of data when running all Suricata versions with our automation process, so it's a bit inefficient how we gather those logs. And as said before, we use Suricata as a tool to get a distribution about our app layer protocols, and maybe this could be improved in the future as well. But with the method we've done it, we think that we can say that we have a coverage of every protocol Suricata supports. The open tasks are how do we integrate this into the official Suricata reader docs. It could look like this, but maybe the community has some other requirements and we need to discuss that today or on Friday. We also would like to encourage you to add missing PCAPs, missing features, missing fields. If you find something, please give us a GitHub pull request. And of course, we need to do some code polishing. So we would like to ask who wants to fill up the gaps, who wants to help fill the gaps with us. And there is the link to the GitHub repo. So let's get started. Thank you.
Yeah, and of course, if there are any questions, we'd be happy to answer them. So the question was whether we've looked at Suricata verified PCAPs. Answer is easy, no, we haven't. But that's something we'd look at.
I have a question about the data types. So JSON is quite limited in the data model. And source IP and destination IP, they are IP addresses and not just strings. Have you any plans to go deeper into the data and actually extract the semantics so that you can add annotations? This is not just a string, but this is an IP address. That would be really helpful for downstream processing when there's a more typed analysis of the data.
Yeah, so the question was whether we could expect more semantically sensible documentation of the value types, so to just go beyond the strings and integers to add some information about whether something's an IP address or not. This is obviously something that Jensen can't do, because that is supposed to be a generic tool. But I think this is probably something that can be done afterwards as part of the curation process. I think that's the most natural place to do it, right? Any other questions?
Yeah. Other question. So what's the output so that this can be integrated into an automated processing? Is there a YAML file or another JSON schema that you'll maintain? Or what do you think, besides the integration into the official documentation, what do you think is the ideal way to distribute this information programmatically?
So the question is what the actual output, what is the result of the whole process that people can actually use. So at the moment, the GitHub repository contains JSON schema files per version. There's no integrated file yet, but I think this is one of the things that we need to discuss. What would actually be useful to you guys to actually have? We have tooling to create the read the docs documentation. So I would probably go for two two approaches. Just have a documentation that's human readable, that can be curated with arbitrary text, and then probably one JSON schema file that contains similar information, but it's probably less verbose, that can be used for automated processing of the whole thing. So these two things. All right. Thank you very much then.
Thank you.